Welcome to the Getting Started with GeoStudio video series. This tutorial introduces how to use the TempW product of GeoStudio 2012. This tutorial video has been designed to help walk new users through the basics of setting up a simple heat transfer analysis in TempW. So, if you are new to TempW and are not sure where to start, you have come to the right place. The main topics that will be covered in the tutorial will be how to create an analysis in TempW by using the Define View to set up the analysis, the Solve Manager to solve the numerical analysis, and the options available in Results View to gain a deeper understanding of the analysis. If you are not familiar with GeoStudio products, it is recommended that you start with the tutorial videos for SeepW, SigmaW, or SlopeW to gain an understanding of the tools available for drawing your geometry domain, creating sketches, or explanations on basic options that are available in all GeoStudio products. This tutorial video will mainly discuss TempW options and tools, where they differ from SeepW, SigmaW, or SlopeW. So, let's get started. Here is a schematic of an ice skating rink that is being installed. The objective of our simulation is to compute the depth of the frozen zone that will develop beneath the ice surface if the temperature of the ice is maintained at -5 degrees Celsius for a period of 100 days, or approximately 3.5 months. Outside the ice surface, the flow in the building is assumed to be insulated so that no heat can cross over this area. Prior to placing the ice, the ground temperatures are steady at 3 degrees Celsius at the surface and 3.1 degrees Celsius at a depth of 4 meters. The material model used for the simulation will be the full thermal model to incorporate the unfrozen water content curve, but constant frozen and unfrozen thermal conductivities and heat capacities will be used. We will start with a steady state heat transfer analysis already created, with our ground regions already drawn. The sketch polyline command was used to create the drawings of our ice rink boards and spectator seating to help visualize the problem. If you are unsure of how to use the visualization sketching tools or draw the geometry regions, please refer to the Sketching Tools and Geometry video tutorial or the Introduction tutorial videos to SeepW, SigmaW, or SlopeW. Now we will add the material to our analysis. I will go to Key In, Materials, to open the Materials Define window. I will add a new material and give my material a name. I will then choose the Full Thermal option from the drop-down menu. Here, I can create a thermal conductivity and unfrozen volumetric water content function for each of my materials. More information on the thermal model options can be viewed in the TempW Estimating Thermal Property Functions tutorial video. We will first add the thermal conductivity versus temperature function by clicking on the ellipsis button. We will add a thermal conductivity function and give it a name. We will then choose the spline data point function option and simply create a constant thermal conductivity function by adding a temperature of 0 degrees Celsius and a thermal conductivity value of 165 kilojoules per day per meter per degree Celsius. I will then return to the Key In Materials Define window and choose my constant function from the drop-down menu. Next, I will add an unfrozen water content function by clicking on the appropriate ellipsis button. I will add a spline data point function again, except this time I will use the internal estimation algorithms to define my function by clicking on the estimate button. In this case, I simply choose the clay material from the drop-down menu, and an unfrozen water content function will be created. If desired, I can choose the Edit Data Points option to see how the curve fits my data points, move my data points with the left mouse button, or view my data points by scrolling through the point list. Here, I could add or paste in data points if available. I will now go back to the Key in Materials Define window and choose my unfrozen water content function from the drop-down menu. As my volumetric heat capacity values are constant during either the freezing or thawing temperature range, I will use an unfrozen volumetric heat capacity of 2300 kilojoules per cubic meter per degree Celsius and a frozen volumetric heat capacity of 1900 kilojoules per cubic meter per degree Celsius. The in situ volumetric water content will be set to 0.5. The activation temperature option allows you to choose a specific temperature for the entire material when it first becomes active in the simulation. However, we will not use this option in this analysis. Now, we will add the material to our domain by choosing Draw Materials. We will simply choose the clay material and assign it to both of the regions representing the ground below the ice rink. Boundary conditions can be created and assigned in a similar way as the materials. I will choose Key in Boundary Conditions to open the Define Boundary Conditions window. For the initial conditions, we will add two constant temperature boundary conditions. The surface boundary condition will be set to 3 degrees Celsius, and the boundary condition representing the temperature at 4 meters below the surface will be set to 3.1 degrees Celsius. I will change the color of this last boundary condition so that it is easier to see which boundary condition we are applying to our domain. We will then go to Draw Boundary Conditions and add these two boundary conditions to the surface and 4-meter depth lines. Our last step of developing our numerical analysis is to view our finite element mesh. You can view the finite element mesh by choosing Draw Mesh Properties. Here, we can see that the default mesh is set to have an approximate global element size of 0.21 meters. We will change the discretization for the global mesh by changing this value to 0.5 meters. Thinking ahead to our second analysis, where we will be conducting a transient simulation of the freezing temperatures created along the surface of the ice, we will also change the discretization within the region directly below the ice rink. We will first highlight this region, and then change the meshing option to a rectangular grid of quadrilaterals. We will then choose two of the lines representing the boundaries of this region. Click on the Length of option in the drop-down menu and choose the length of 0.075 meters. Now we can solve our initial analysis by toggling on our analysis in the Solve Manager window and clicking on the Start button. Once solved, the window will automatically change to the Results view instead of the Define view. By default, the temperature contours, thermal velocity vectors, and phase change line within the domain will show once the analysis has been solved. The Results Times window allows you to see what time steps have been solved and allows you to view the contours within the domain for different time steps. Since we are conducting a steady state analysis, there is only one time step available of 0 seconds. You can change the contours that are being shown on the domain in the results window by choosing a different contour type in the drop-down menu. You can also add new contour options by clicking on the Draw Contours button. You can change the shading methods used to draw your contours. Add a legend. Or change the increments and starting and ending values of your contours. Other items can be added by clicking on the Add button and choosing the type of results contour you would like to create. You can add labels to your contours using the Draw Contour Labels button and clicking on the contour lines where you want labels to be painted. Here, you can change the visualization of the thermal velocity vectors by clicking on the Draw Vectors button. Here, you can turn on and off the vectors, change the maximum vector length or the magnification of the vectors. You can choose what items are active in the results window at any time using the View Preferences toolbar along the right side of the screen. Here, you can toggle on or off results information, such as the velocity vectors, contours, or you can view your mesh, boundary conditions, material properties, or toggle on and off geometry items, such as the regions or point numbers. More information on the other options available in the results view can be viewed in the Seep W, Sigma W, or Slope W tutorial videos. Now, let's return to the Define view and open the Key In Analyses window. Here we will add a transient temp W analysis. This adds a second heat transfer analysis to our analysis tree, with the initial conditions steady state analysis considered as the parent analysis. Multiple analyses can be added to the analysis tree to allow the user to solve multiple scenarios within the same project file. The geometry of the domain is considered project specific, but the material properties and boundary conditions can be modified to simulate different scenarios of the analysis. I will change the name of my analysis and ensure that my parent steady state analysis is being used to describe the initial temperature profiles of my transient analysis. Next, we will check the convergence settings of our analysis. It is recommended that you refer to the Convergence and UR Settings tutorial video, online help, or the Temp W Engineering book for more information on the Convergence tab. Note, the current maximum number of iterations is set to 50. We will change our solver type to the Direct Equation Solver because this is a simple problem with a small mesh. Next, we will go to the Time tab and increase the duration of my analysis to 100 days. We will make the steps increase exponentially with an initial increment size of 2 days. Now we are ready to change the boundary conditions of our transient analysis to simulate the freezing temperature of the ice surface. We will first go to Key In, Boundary Conditions, to add a temperature boundary condition that will represent the ice temperature. We will create another constant temperature boundary condition and change the temperature to -5°C. Again, we will change the color of the boundary condition for visualization purposes. Now, we will go to Draw Boundary Conditions and remove the ground surface temperature by holding down the left mouse button and dragging a box over the lines with this boundary condition. We will then add the freezing ice temperature along the line representing the ice surface. We will keep the material properties and lower boundary condition the same. We will now return to the Solve Manager to solve the transient analysis. The results view will automatically open since we are solving the analysis highlighted in the analysis tree. The settings that we had set in our previous analysis in the results view have been saved, so we can now see our updated temperature contours and phase change surface. We can change the time step we are viewing by clicking on the desired time in the results time window. We will simply click on the last time step of 100 days to view how deep the phase change surface has moved into the clay soil. Next, we will create some results graphs to help us gain a better understanding of our analysis. We will first check the convergence of our transient analysis by adding a graph and choosing Data from Domain Each Time Step in the drop-down menu. We can see the convergence parameters are being reported with the iteration count versus time in our graph. Remember, the default maximum number of iterations was set to 50 in our convergence tab. As we can see in this graph, the maximum iteration of 50 was never reached. Therefore, we can say that the convergence has been reached in all time steps of our analysis. Next, we will create a graph showing the cumulative heat flux across the ice surface throughout the 100-day duration. We will choose heat flow, cumulative thermal flux, and time, and then choose our locations. We will simply choose the geometry item type from the drop-down menu and click on the line representing the ice surface. Now, we will click on the sum y versus average x values so that we can see the cumulative thermal flux for the entire ice surface instead of each individual node. Now, we will choose all time steps, and our graph will update with the cumulative thermal flux values for each time step in the transient analysis. The last graph we will create in this tutorial will be the temperature profile along the line below the ice surface. We will keep the temperature options from the drop-down menus and choose the geometry line below the ice surface for our location. We will change the x-axis to y as our location is along a vertical line. We can choose all time steps again and then go to More, Options, to rotate our graph so that our elevation occurs along the y-axis. We have now reached the end of this introductory tutorial. Note that not all of the powerful features of TempW 2012 have been used or discussed here. Further information on each command can be found in the online help supporting documentation for TempW, as well as in other tutorial videos of the Getting Started with GeoStudio video series. Thank you for watching.